You see, since you mentioned about blue economy and your interest in blue economy, we in fact have taken out our second report on blue economy, which is a sectoral report. In fact, that report was released by Honorable Minister himself just before the pandemic, in fact. And also, I am a member of a steering committee under Prime Minister's Economic Advisory Council on Blue Economy. And that report has, in fact, come out only about a week ago. And now we are working on a third phase of our Blue Economy report, and that is between FICCI, TERI, and there's a German organization called CAS. So, Atanu, I'd be very happy to come and discuss about blue economy and maritime security, since you mentioned that specifically. Now, you see, after listening to the Honorable Minister, Professor Dubey, Professor Pandey, and other speakers, I think most of the issues have already been covered. I was wondering, how can he add value to what they have already said? Since you mentioned, I head Diaspora Research and Resource Center at ARSP. I think this will be relevant for me to say something about ARSP and DRRC. In fact, Antarrashtriya Sahyog Parishad is a non-government, non-profit organization, which in fact has been working on diaspora matters for over 40 years now. Atanu, there was hardly any setup in the official circles 40 years ago for specifically dealing with diaspora issues beyond the consular and passport matters. But ARSP was already working on diaspora issues, both in the NRI area and also in the PIO area. And that experience of ARSP, in fact, one of your speakers mentioned about that committee which was set up to go into the diaspora matters under Dr. L. M. Singhvi, which in fact made some recommendations, and those recommendations then led to a lot of changes in our policy to deal with diaspora, including the OCI, PIO, and the Pravasi Bharatiya thing. And then later on, a lot of things I can go over those issues, but that will require a separate presentation. Now, DRRC was set up in ARSP with the support of Ministry of External Affairs, primarily to upgrade the ARSP's engagement with diaspora with a specific research content. That is what we are doing there. Now, you see, having dealt with diaspora when this pandemic occurred, of course, DRRC and ARSP had to kind of stay ahead of the curve and start thinking how this pandemic is going to impact diaspora and what kind of problems they may face and what would need to be done by the government in terms of policy adjustment and adaptation for helping those people. We under the ARSP, in fact, we have organized a series of sectoral dialogue with diaspora in Americas, diaspora in Gulf, diaspora in the Girmitia countries, and diaspora in the Indian Ocean region. Now, what I'll do, because since most of the issues have already been covered by the Honorable Minister and Professor Dubey, I will try to share with you what the diaspora shared with us in our series of conferences as to how COVID is going to impact and what needs to be done. As the Honorable Minister said, the battle is just halfway. A lot of implications are still in the waiting, and we need to be prepared for that. Now, first is, people might sometimes think that this is the first crisis that we are facing, or this is the first time that we have evacuated Indians from other regions. I would take them back. In fact, it's a long story. Because when we talk about demographic dividend, we in fact long ago we had been talking about the possibility of India becoming the manpower, skilled manpower supplier for the global industry. That is what happened, in fact, in the last about, though the Indian diaspora story goes back by centuries, rather, I can take you back to the Kalinga times, but I will come to the later post-independence period. Over the last 30 years, in fact, a large number of Indian skilled, unskilled, semi-skilled professionals have traveled all over the world. As a result, today we have 30, almost 31, 32 million members of diaspora, which includes the NRIs and PIOs, spread over more than 100 countries. And this diaspora has, in fact, become a very, very important soft power bridge for India. They are playing a bridge role in terms of politics, in terms of culture, in terms of people-to-people contact, in terms of economy, in terms of technology, in terms of technology transfers. And we are so proud of what the diaspora, Indian diaspora, has done for the global community and also for India. But then, when you have such a large diaspora, and when you have such expectation from them, on the other hand, we also need to be prepared, just in case there is a situation of crisis and we have to help our diaspora spread all over the world. In fact, I remember, we started dealing with diaspora crisis from the Gulf War. We dealt with Gulf War I, Gulf War II, Libya, Lebanon, all those crises. We moved large number of people back to India under those operations also. But the question is, this crisis as we are dealing with today, is qualitatively different from those crises. This is absolutely unprecedented. You see, in most of the evacuations, earlier evacuations, though the numbers were very large, we ran into millions of people who were brought back to India. But it was mostly a two-way traffic. You see, there was a place from where we were supposed to bring people back, and they had to be brought back to India. And once they touched India, they had, a fallback position to look after themselves. But this is the first time that we are facing a crisis where literally every country is suffering the consequences. As a result, when you have to manage, say, large number of source points for evacuation of Indians, believe me, it's not an easy task. It's a Herculean task. It's very complex, because you are not only dealing with a crisis, but also there are local laws, there are local restrictions, there are local regulations. Now, once you combine all those things, it is not an easy task to mobilize people from so many countries in such large number. I think India has done probably, I would say, amongst the best in terms of taking our bringing our people back to India. This is an extraordinary job which we have performed, and I'm sure we should be proud of that. Let me tell you, in terms of evacuation, in case of disaster relief, world over today, India is seen as a role model, because we have shown to the world, we have not only evacuated our people from the crisis zone, but we have also evacuated people, nationals of other countries, especially our neighboring countries, who may not have the capacity to do it. So I think in terms of the evacuation part, we have done fairly well, though when you have diaspora exceeding 30 million, dealing with that number is not easy. There would always be people who would not be able to reach out, who would not be able to get assistance in time, or who might really get caught in complex web of regulations. I heard Professor Pandey mentioning about the OCI card holders. In one of our conferences, in fact, this point was mentioned because when we had to stop the foreigners coming to India, foreigners means the OCIs are also foreigners. In fact, they are foreign nationals. And they got caught in this process. And there were many cases where the parents were Indian passport holders and the children were foreign passport holders, but with OCI. Now, with the children, the parents also got stuck. So when this was brought to the attention of the ministry, they immediately rectified this and responded to this. I have been in touch with our missions in many countries because we were receiving some distress calls in India, and knowing that I am from Foreign Service, so they were telling me, can you please contact your particular embassy to find assistance for their loved one who was stuck there. And whenever I contacted them, you know, they knew the person I was talking about. They knew the difficulty the person was facing in that country, and they came forward to help. You see, in fact, one of the earlier speakers mentioned about, you know, the embassies are not proactive. I think there was a time when this opinion was probably right to some extent, but since, you know, the start of the PBD process and other engagement tools, today the embassies cannot stay silent if a member of Indian diaspora is suffering. Let me tell you my own experience. I was in many countries. Because of the proactive involvement and action by the Indian missions abroad, Indian origin foreigners would come to us for help. Can you imagine? I have had situations where, in fact, a foreign national but of Indian origin got into difficulty and their own embassy was not able to help. They came to us and we helped, you know. So I think when it comes to the embassies being proactive, the embassies are doing, I think, what they can. You have to remember these things require tremendous amount of resources. And in many cases, our embassies are working with very, very limited resources. You know, we have to understand, we are still a developing country. We cannot really, really pump in money without any limits whenever we need. So we have limited resources, but within the limited resources, I think the amount of job our people have done is absolutely extraordinary. And for the Ministry of External Affairs runs what is called a situation room, which in fact I set up long ago. It was almost about 20 years ago. And this situation room, even 20 years ago,